The easiest diagnosis for a psychiatrist to make is for a person who is diametrically opposed to the psychiatric system itself that's doing the diagnosing.
Yeah, well, the leading up to my current problems with the psychiatrist, I'd have to say that I haven't had any problem with the psychiatrist for about 2 years, partly because I didn't criticize psychiatry to the psychiatrist, and I was getting on with my work as a general practitioner and doing my own private research and my own publication. And then in November last year, I self-published my book, which is quite openly critical of psychiatry and suggesting that the treatment that they are, the current treatments for schizophrenia are inappropriate, and both the diagnosis kills the people as well as the drugs. The psychiatrist, you could say without actually reading the whole book, described the book and the art within the book, and there's a lot of art in the book, that this was somehow indicative of delusional thinking, as a diagram like, a drawing like that. As to how they place themselves as art critics now, as well as psychiatrists, is anybody's guess. But I do mention that avoiding, this is actually what they read that before they called me delusionally disordered, or having delusional disorder. I'd have to say that they haven't been too hard on the diagnosis of delusional disorder. They're not quite sure whether I might have schizoaffective disorder or schizophrenia. Or they've been throwing a lot of major psychosis labels at me over the past 3 years. 8 or 9. I've had...
How many different doctors?
25, 26, maybe a bit more than that, maybe up to 30. The diagnoses that I've been given are hypomania, mania, manic depression, even though I've never actually been depressed, paranoid psychosis, schizophrenia, schizoaffective disorder, delusional disorder, personality disorder. These diagnoses are actually contradictory with each other, but the psychiatrists haven't been able to see that. And in this particular little diagram, I've started off by saying avoiding drug treatment with phenothiazines will avoid permanent damage to the basal ganglia and limbic system. The reason I say this, it says, I've said these are responsible for secondary schizophrenic deterioration, tardive dyskinesia, amotivational syndrome, chronic depression, and emotional flatness. These are considered to be the side effects, the symptoms of chronic schizophrenia, amotivational syndrome, chronic depression, emotional flatness, and a splintering of the personality and ability to think. But major tranquilizers cause an inability to think, and they cause difficulty with movement, and they cause difficulty with your emotions and expression of your emotions, and a stiffness in your face. So that people's emotions don't register on their face. But they also say things like inappropriate affects, that if you laugh at a psychiatrist and they don't know why you're laughing, they'll say that you could be schizophrenic.
So
that sort of thing.
If for the psychiatrists, if you're diseased of the mind, there's no cure, then what are the point of these drugs?
To
support the diagnosis?
To make your behavior more manageable. Control, in other words. To control the symptoms, and the symptoms are not necessarily things that the person is actually complaining of, they're things that either the community or the employer or the psychiatrist is complaining about.
Is that because the patient lacks insight?
Well, they describe lack of insight as a lack of preparedness to accept the diagnosis. So in my case, of course, I was plagued with an accusation of lack of insight.
Is that what they'll be arguing on Wednesday?
They will be arguing that on Wednesday, saying that my lack of preparedness to accept that I'm mad is evidence that I'm mad. And that is something that is a bit of a catch-22 and is something that is responsible for a lot of people being incarcerated in Australia and also repeatedly put onto community treatment orders where treatment is forced on them because they refuse to accept that they need treatment.
So what really gives the psychiatrists their authority?
What gives them their authority? Well,
I mean, it seems a lot of things go on behind closed doors. people knew about this, what would happen to psychiatry?
Hopefully they will get to know about it, and hopefully they'll start asking some questions of the psychiatrists. Psychiatrists don't like answering questions, so when people tend to ask them questions, they'll just refuse to answer, deflect the question.
So in the history of psychology, has there been many people like yourself that have been or that have challenged or questioned the tenets of psychiatry, and how have they been responded to by psychiatry?
Not favourably. There have been psychiatrists. I don't know about general practitioners challenging psychiatry, because even though I'm a general practitioner, obviously I have developed an expertise in the neurosciences, and in particular I've spent a lot of time researching the brain, which is something that most general practitioners don't do. Most doctors are unprepared to challenge the authority of psychiatrists, because they'll say, there's a lot, as I said, a lot of expert disease that goes on. So they'll say, yeah, well, we have our concerns about psychiatry, but we're not psychiatrists, so we're not experts in it. And there are a number of psychologists who have been quite openly critical of psychiatry, and psychological books. A guy called Seth Farber, who's a psychologist in America, has written a very good book called Man as Heresy in the Room of Angels, where he talks about, he discusses it with a guy called Liebner, I think, because I might be wrong on the name, but he's a anti-psychiatry psychiatrist who actually talks about psychiatry being used for the purposes of social control.
And how has he been responded to?
Well, he actually studied under Thomas Sass, and Thomas Sass started a whole movement in America, in Syracuse, where some of the psychiatrists who are brought up with psychoanalytical theory have been looking much more in a psychological way at the development of psychological problems, very different from the biomedical paradigm.
So what would Freud say of psychiatry in this modern age?
I wouldn't like to preempt what Freud would say.
What might you suggest?
What might I suggest?
Or would you rather steer clear of that?
I'd steer clear of that. I mean, I don't like to speculate on something like that. But, well, you could say that Freud was one of the founders of psychoanalysis, and psychoanalytical theory is quite different from the biomedical paradigm. And that's looking for psychologically developed, particularly Freud was particularly interested or somewhat obsessed even by early childhood sexual experiences, etc., as a shaper of later psychological problems. So he was much closer still to my paradigm than the biomedical people, who are really just saying, we don't know what the cause of any of this madness is, and we'll probably never know. We don't know how any of the drugs work, but they make things better. We don't know how shock treatment works, but it makes people better.
So it's constant experimenting.
Yeah, the thing is that making people better, if you're diagnosing the person as being mad because they're talking too much, then any drug that stops people from talking and effectively paralyzes their speech is going to make the person better. But they're not actually feeling better. They're just not being as noisy and not saying things that they're not supposed to say. The punitive attitude of psychiatry and the punitive treatments do have a very strong effect in stopping people from talking about things. And I mean, I recognized that when I was in the hospital, and I spent 4 months locked up in psychiatric hospitals over the last 3 years. And so I've met a lot of people who have been diagnosed as being mad in different ways. Some of those people were mad, but certainly slugging them with antipsychotics and telling them that they were mad, so that they, on addition to that, lose their self-confidence and become stigmatized and become paranoid about how other people are thinking about them. It doesn't make the madness go away, it just reinforces the madness and makes them believe that they're mad and somehow alien and different from everyone else who's somehow sane. As I've gone looking through the community, I don't feel that the people that I've met in psychiatric hospitals have been any madder than people that I've met on the outside. They've just been unfortunate enough to get involved into the system. And